Then we got humanism, which puts it a little bit right for some of us. I like to think of myself as a humanistic behaviorist. I like the humanist perspective. The humanist perspective is not focused so much on the negative things that are happening with people. You look at psychoanalysis, and really it's a reaction to seeing that people struggle with mental health issues, with happiness, fulfillment, anxiety, mental disorders like schizophrenia or bipolar. And how do we get that way, and how do we fix it? So that's a reasonable line of inquiry, yeah? But the flip side of that is, look at all the things we're capable of as human beings. We can do all kinds of stuff. We're a pretty amazing species. We have great potential. We do wonderful things, and we should look at that side too. So they say, yes, we do have free will. All right? William James said, my first act of free will be to believe in free will. That's fun, isn't it? You get that? My first act of free will be to believe in free will. So humanists believe in free will. They think you have a choice. It doesn't appear like you have a choice sometimes. You feel trapped in your situations, but you have a potential that's untapped. And that untapped potential, if you can learn how to do it, can be released and propel you forward through the worst of times and bring out the best in you and others. Y'all have a great, great weekend. I hope to see everybody in here on Monday. We left off last time talking about humanism and humanism's rather positive take on humanity. We talked about several schools that you should know about now. Structuralism, associated with Wundt. 1879, he started his psych lab, right? Looking at the structure of consciousness. Looking at functionalism, associated with William James, looking at the function of consciousness and how it helps us as a species to adapt, right? Psychoanalysis, the Freudian point of view early on, but much changed since Freud had his first say about the matter. And still, in that vein, we're looking at you not being a master of your own fate, but being, in some ways, the victim of the circumstances of your upbringing, but in an unconscious way. And then we see, we had behaviorism talk about B.F. Skinner and John Watson, talking about behavior being the only thing worth studying because it's objective, observable, therefore quantifiable. We can make meaningful measurements of it. And we can manipulate the environment because we see that people have different consequences in different situations, and that leads to predictable behavior. But still, you're not the master of your own fate there, but really the sum total of your cumulative life learning experiences. And that has kind of an odd flavor to it, thinking we don't have free will, that we don't really have control over our lives, but yet we feel like we do. And then along come the humanists. People like Carl Rogers and Abraham Maslow who say, yeah, actually we do have free will. Life is hard. Life throws it at you, creates a bunch of obstacles. But if there were no obstacles, you'd have no choice but to be all you could be, right? You'd have to rise up to your total fruition. But the world doesn't allow you to do that. It holds you down. So you get stuck. And then you think that you can't get out of that position, and therefore you stay there. But if we can enlighten you as to your full potential and give you some techniques, you could rise to your full potential. You could overcome the obstacles and be all that you could be. And that's the humanist point of view. So we had that as the third force in psychology. Now we've talked about some dominant, not ancient paradigms, but some of our foundational early paradigms in psychology. Some of these elements we keep with us yet today. Others we've discarded. And you'll see as we go through the course, elements that fit kind of in all of these paradigms. And we'll talk about each of those a little more explicitly as we go through. I'm going to finish you off with a couple other perspectives, three specifically, that I want you to know for your tests, because they bring another angle to understanding people. None of them has all of the information. None of them have all of the answers. In fact, all of them together don't have all the answers. But all of them have perspectives worth considering, and we'll be talking about these perspectives throughout the semester. So it's nice to know the foundations. It's a little hard to show the practical value of this knowledge. But if you like a subject, it's good to know from whence it came. So cognitive psychology focuses on mental processes. Cognition simply means mental processes. It's a synonym. So when we talk about cognitive psychology, we're talking about the way you think. As differentiated from the actual brain mechanisms that allow you to think, the thinking itself. So we have to figure that it's hard to know how we know things. If this was easy to understand, we would have understood it a long time ago. But philosophers have been arguing for centuries upon centuries about how we acquire knowledge. How do we know that we know anything? How do we remember it? How do we pull it back out when it's relevant? How come we're so selective in our memories anyway? So cognitive psychology looks at how we direct attention, how we perceive situations, and how we solve problems. Because as we'll get into that chapter on the way we think a little more deeply, we'll talk about problem solving. It's kind of something we do all day, every day. We just don't usually call it that. Social cognitive theory is adding on the behaviorist point of view. The learning chapter will be talking about that very much in to this cognitive perspective, because the behaviorist didn't really care for cognition. It's inside what they call the black box. It's in your head. I can't get at it, therefore it's not something I can study. But then we realize that all behaviors occur in social environments, and learning does occur in a way that's inside your head. Just because you can't see it doesn't mean it doesn't happen. It doesn't mean we shouldn't explore it and try to understand it to the best of our ability. So the social cognitive theory says we do all of our learning in a way that embeds us in a social environment and then cements the way we tend to think about things. And categorically is how we think about things. We are judging machines. It doesn't take you but a second to look at something and decide what it is. Even if you're wrong, you still made a decision. Right? You have a guess at what it is because you are able to perceive and categorize really quickly, which is usually adaptive, but can be maladaptive at times, especially when we apply our quick categorizations and judgments to other human beings who are by definition much more complicated than the objects we perceive in our environment. So social cognitive, but particularly cognitive psychology, is the perspective I'd like you to know. Biological psychology, you could also call it biopsychology, as it's called in some books, looks at the brain and the nervous system, the physical underlying mechanisms that allow us to do our thinking and really allow us to do our existing. Right? Without a brain, we don't exist. Not on this plane. You got to have something to make the heart pump. You got to have something to make the lungs work. Something has always got to be functioning at all times for us to live. And the brain drives that activity physically. That's what allows us to exist. Everything we think about anything, everything we feel about everything, anything we do, brain is involved. Brain and nervous system is something we're going to focus on here shortly after we go through the research portion of this first section of material. But it also looks at genetics as well. So when we talk about biology, we're talking about our core physical self. It gets here as a product of genetic transmission, right? DNA replicating. And here we are. And then we make more of us, and there they are. And a lot of people make a lot of genetics, and certainly a lot can be made of it, because without it, we don't exist. It gives us the framework in which we find ourselves experiencing the world around us. That's the nature side of the nature-nurture debate. But the nurture side has just as much to say about it. How do we become who we are? Well, there's certain kinds of things that are kind of determined. I'm going to be male. I'm going to be around 6 feet tall. I don't have a lot of choice in that, but I can affect that in some ways, whether I express myself as male or express myself as feminine, right? Or whether I eat enough protein to make me grow to 6'1", or I have a deficient diet and it makes me only grow to 5'11", right? I can affect genetics to a certain degree in my environmental interactions, but certainly the way that I come to understand the world around me has a lot to do with the experiences I have in it. So genetics interacts with environment. So nature and nurture, it's not so much of a debate, right? It's both. But some people want to hang their hat real quick on an explanation, especially when something goes wrong. They're like, that's genetic, isn't it? As if that answers all the questions. And so what if it was? In almost all cases, it isn't just genetics, but even if it was, what does that answer a question for you in terms of practical information? How are you going to use that information to help somebody be better? In some cases, we can. We might be able to grow some new organs, but then you're going to have to deal with the replacement of those organs. I guarantee there's going to be a psychological impact at that moment, right? So it's always both, but biological focuses more on the underlying physiology and the underlying transmission of that physiology down through the generations.
And then I want to bring about sociocultural recognition, because as I've alluded to already, your worldview has a lot to do with how you see yourself and how you interact with others around you and what you think about the world around you in general and how you have opportunities provided to you or whether you feel there's limitations in this world. And that sociocultural perspective comes as a function of where you happen to have been born and whom happened to raise you. Right? There's no guarantees of anything in this world except that wherever you get born and raised, you're probably going to adopt a lot of the views of that culture as being correct, because that'll be your in-group, and you're going to view almost all other groups that don't fit in some way or another into that group as out-groups, as potential threats or competitors, or at the very least annoyances, because they don't really understand how things really are like our group does. And so when you have that as a defining self-feature, membership in a group, then the group you happen to be a member of matters. It matters dramatically. And it's oftentimes overlooked by many people because they just assume other people must be crazy, right? They're either mad or they're dangerous, a threat to our way of life, whoever they may be and whoever you may be in whatever group. Any group that ever fought another group thought terrible of them, but guaranteed the people in the other group thought the same way about that group, Kevin, and the consideration of things. So you got to think about people, humanity, as being one species that divides itself up readily into subgroups and then treats those subgroups as if they are, without a doubt, the best thing that ever occurred if they're in it, and sometimes the worst thing that ever occurred if they're not in it. And then there's every kind of variation in between the extremes, right? So looking at that as a emphasis, social and cultural influences, we blend that with some social cognitive psychology, biological perspectives, and some of all of the other perspectives we've talked about thus far. And we get the foundations of our science.